The Big O was one of my favorite shows from when I was a kid. I still remember watching the original run of the show on Toonami back in the day, being captivated by the sleek art style and the cool characters, and of course the awesome giant robots. I think a lot of the deeper, more existential concepts the show often explored kind of went over my head though, but I think it's something I'm able to appreciate a little bit more revisiting the show now as an adult. And with the possible exception of the protagonist, Roger Smith, I think the character through which a lot of those themes of identity and purpose and free will were explored the most was none other than Roger's constant companion, R. Dorothy Wayneright. Introduced in the very first episode, R. Dorothy became one of Roger's most trusted allies, although it certainly took them a bit to warm up to each other on a personal level, thanks in no small part to Roger's insistence on following the rules of his home and his profession, and Dorothy's habit of doing things to question his taste or otherwise annoy him. R. Dorothy's character, as we know it, was the result of the efforts of the show's head writer, Chiaki J. Konaka, a writer who's also worked on the likes of Hellsing, Serial Experiments Lane, and Digimon Tamers. Before Konaka joined the team in 1999, Dorothy was basically just the android who lives with Roger, but Konaka's involvement is what shaped her into the more fleshed-out character she'd become, a trusted ally to Roger Smith that showrunners Kaiichi Sato and Kazuyoshi Katayama described as edgy but lovable. R. Dorothy is easily one of the best characters in the Big O, with her dynamic with Roger being one of the most enjoyable aspects. But it's also pretty fascinating to see how the show uses Dorothy as a catalyst to explore a lot of its more existential themes, like the struggle of finding one's own identity, or whether a person is ruled by their past, or merely informed by it. So, I think y'all know the drill by now. I wanted to look over Dorothy's character arc throughout the 26-episode run of The Big O, and really explore what makes R. Dorothy, well, R. Dorothy. And it's basically a formality for me to say this at this point, but just in case... Big time heckin' spoilers ahead!
Take the time to think about yourself and what could possibly make you tick.
I think about myself more than you do, at least.
Somewhere around 40 years before the events of the Big O, roughly around the same time as the mysterious cataclysm that caused everyone's mass amnesia, a young woman named Dorothy Wayneright lost her life. Some 40 years later, Dorothy's father, Timothy Wayneright, a renowned scientist, used acquired money to commission the construction of a special android, one modeled after his late daughter, and given life and personality based on her memories. That android, of course, being R. Dorothy Wayneright. It's a bittersweet existence, to be sure. I mean, surely the very fact that you're alive, that you have sentience, is amazing, and you have someone who loves and cares for you, but on the other hand, you really only exist to fill the void left behind by someone that your creator lost. Given the circumstances of her existence, it's no wonder that Dorothy would often struggle with the notion that she was built to resemble a dead girl, and that she was powered by said girl's memories. And whether those memories would ever allow her to craft her own identity outside of Timothy Wainwright's replacement daughter. But that certainly doesn't mean that R. Dorothy didn't try. Aside from her penchant for sarcasm and her willingness to poke and prod at Roger, one of the most prominent aspects of her personality has to be her affinity for music. As early as Act 2, Dorothy's talent for music is made very apparent when she sings a song at the Nightingale Club, and from Act 3 onward, she's shown a very strong talent for playing the piano, albeit doing so very mechanically and most of the time as a means to keep Roger from sleeping in, but it's obvious that she loves the music that she makes with her piano and likely considers her love of music as a very important part of her identity. That's made fairly obvious when, after saving Roger from Beck's latest scheme in Act 18, all Dorothy wanted in return was to play the piano unencumbered. And again, it's one of those things where I wonder whether a love of music is something that Dorothy picked up on her own, or if it's some remnant of the memories of the original Dorothy Wayneright, but music is definitely a part of her, one way or another. Regardless of how much it screws up Roger wanting to sleep in.
I thought I was the only one. You're like me.
The general depiction of many robots and androids in media is that of the emotionless, procedural, and unflinchingly logical machine who exhibits little to no actual personal expression. That's not really the case with many of the androids in Paradigm City, but especially not for R. Dorothy. Many people in Paradigm City who meet R. Dorothy are taken aback at the fact that she's an android, due to her exceptionally human-like appearance, and even Roger Smith couldn't tell right away that Dorothy wasn't human when he first met her until it was pointed out to him. Not that he would admit his mistake to her face.
Norman must be senile. How else could he possibly confuse an android for a woman?
You couldn't tell the difference at first either.
It was dark. I couldn't see in that dump.
As early as Act 4, when our Dorothy's presence accidentally awakens an old, obsolete Megaduce archetype, her voice takes on a much higher inflection as she expresses what can only be genuine terror at the thought of this thing trying to come after her and the memories that she contains.
No, it cannot be! That thing is no friend of mine. I have no idea where it came from. It can't be! That thing should not be allowed to exist anywhere!
No, it can't be. No.
And in general, Dorothy seems to behave more human-like and expressive around those to whom she's grown attached. It takes a bit of time for her to open up more to Roger, but it does happen eventually. And a far earlier example of this is when she's reunited with her creator-slash-father, Timothy Wayneright, in Act 2, becoming a bit more expressive and acting more like the happy daughter of a scientist, even singing a song for Timothy on stage. Of course, I think the most impactful instance of Dorothy's capacity for emotion and human sentimentality, that has to be during Act 8, Missing Cat. As the title implies, our Dorothy discovers a lost cat hiding from the rain, immediately taking it back to Roger's mansion and treating the cat like her own pet. As it turns out, cats are, for whatever reason, quite rare in Paradigm City. So rare, in fact, that this cat, which Dorothy names Paro, was actually the result of genetic experiments intended to repopulate dogs and cats into the city. In other words, Paro wasn't born naturally, but rather was an artificial creation of science that was then given life and sentience, just like Dorothy. It's likely that shared kind of artificial existence that caused Dorothy and Paro to bond so quickly, but it wouldn't last. It's not long before they're both kidnapped by a geneticist turned mad scientist named Eugene Grant, a scientist with a god complex who uses Paro as raw genetic material to create a giant monstrous chimera, a slapdash amalgamation of dozens, if not hundreds, of other creatures. Roger and Big O step in to fight the monster in a brawl that nearly destroys Eugene's lab, but just before Roger readies Big O for sudden impact to land the final blow, Dorothy urges him to stop, revealing that Paro's genes, and maybe even his soul, as it were, are still within the Chimera. Eventually, Dorothy's able to appeal to the essence of Paro within the beast, causing it to betray and kill Eugene. However, when Dorothy offers to take Paro home and care for him, even in his current condition, Paro refuses. Sadly, he chooses instead to walk into the burning, collapsing ruins of Eugene's lab, taking his own life, not only to end what surely must have been a painful existence, but perhaps to end the suffering of all the other creatures Eugene had experimented on. We then see Dorothy looking at the destroyed laboratory, and although she can't create tears for herself, the pouring rain on her face is the perfect visual metaphor for her sorrow, trying to cope with the loss of someone who is just like her. All throughout the episode, Roger contemplates whether Dorothy's love for Paro is the result of her own affections, or if she's simply being driven by the memories of the original Dorothy that were used to create her, but in this case, maybe that sort of thing didn't matter. Dorothy was able to bond with a creature much like herself, to tap into some measure of humanity that may not have been present before. And honestly, maybe that's enough.
Why did you... You didn't have to...
People always do crazy things when they're in love.
Of course, beyond any other aspect of our Dorothy's personality that alluded to her humanity beneath her android exterior, it has to be the love that she feels for Roger Smith. Now, to be fair, the two of them never really officially got together in any meaningful way by the end of the show, but there's constant hints at a possible romantic future for the two of them, and they have a ton of great chemistry together. Not to mention, in an interview for a site called Anime Dream, our Dorothy's English voice actress, Leah Sargent, all but straight up says that Dorothy was, in fact, in love with Roger. And it's not like the show shied away from the possibility either. At the end of every episode, during the end credits sequence, the song that plays, And Forever, is a duet between a male and female singer, with the implication being that it's Dorothy, who we already know can sing and has a knack for music, and Roger, the man she loves. If you want to stick to implications in the actual plot, though, when Dorothy rescues Roger from Beck in Act 18, she flat out says that Roger is the man she loves, before quickly implying that she was just trying to lighten the mood with a joke, but was that really a joke, though, or just the use of the classic haha JK unless? And if you want a more serious implication, though, at the end of Act 9, Dorothy asks Roger, Had they met under different circumstances? Had she perhaps been human? If he would have fallen in love with her? And of course, Roger, still deep in I have to be a professional at all times mode, dodges the question and doesn't really answer it, but towards the end of the third to last episode, after Beck and an army of scorpion robots lay waste to Roger's mansion and make off with Dorothy's memory circuits, Roger confides in an inanimate Dorothy, telling her that, yeah, maybe he would have. There's also been multiple times where characters like Beck have attempted to mess with Dorothy's memory circuits, the core technological component that should dictate who she is and how she behaves, and yet Dorothy has shown the ability to override that, breaking free from the influence of Beck's control device in Act 9 before she unwittingly kills Roger, and even springing back to life in order to help Roger unlock Big O's final stage attack in the finale, despite Beck literally ripping her memory circuit drive out of her head, something that should have, in some sense, basically killed her. Our Dorothy obviously was able to do these things not only through sheer force of will, but also, as cheesy as this may sound, through the power of love. The love that she felt for Roger Smith, developed over time thanks to their shared experience and great chemistry. And personally, that power of love and devotion and dedication to someone else? To me, that's the one thing that truly makes our Dorothy as human as anyone else in the show, in spite of her status as an android. That love that allows her to defy the limitations of her being and her creation, to tap into a humanity not thought possible by even her own creator. In the wise words of another being who was also artificially born as a result of science,
I see now that the circumstances of one's birth are irrelevant. It is what you do with the gift of life that determines who you are.
But now I'd like to hear from you! What do you think of our Dorothy as a character? Let me know in the comments below! Give this video a like if you liked it, subscribe for more videos like this in the future, and ring the bell so you get notified when I upload! See you in the next video, friendos!